This is Frank Cesario. Frank Cesario is here in the audience. This is his life autobiography. He wrote it 10 years ago, and his kid says, hey, you know, you update it, you could update it. It's been 10 years since you wrote it. So he is switching to the same size as Colleen Book, the 8.5 by 11. He's switching to the 8.5 by 11 size from the smaller book. And this is similar to what it's gonna look like. We're still working on it very intensely. And we'll be done with it within a month or so. But these are the different programs that we have that you can work with to get your book published with God's Italia. As I said, I'm the consulting editor for that. So we will get your book out there for you without minimal problems. And all you have to do is submit your copy. If it's handwritten, it's got to be clear, but otherwise, typewritten copy would be perfect to work with so that you can go ahead and submit it to me. I'll work with you. We'll edit the book. Like I said, don't worry about spelling. Don't worry about phrasing and all that because I can fix it up. You know, and that will give you a copy of a book that you can go ahead and present to your family for the holidays. You can surprise everybody with your intelligence and genius by showing them what the hell you can do. But, you know, so this is the idea. So with the Arcoli Dental Art Society, I found that it's a great organization. I've been lucky enough to be invited to 2 or 3 of their different events. And it's a very gracious organization. It's one of the most fun organizations I've ever seen. They're not stick in the mud and formal. They're very collegial. They're very friendly with everyone. And it's too bad it's not an open organization, because they have too damn much fun. That's all that is.
CJ, do you get free dental from
You would think my cousin would do that for me.
All right, let's have a little fun, because that's what we do at our meetings. As the historian for the Arcolians, my motto is, let's never have a regular meeting. Let's not just have a lecture and then everyone goes home and forgets it. It's just another meeting. So with that in mind, I invented what I call the PCP approach, which stands for Promote, Celebrate, and Preserve Our Great Heritage and Profession. So that being said, if I just told you about an Arcoli meeting, you'd probably forget. But if I let you experience a little bit of an Arcoli meeting, you'd probably never forget. So here's a little taste of what we do at our meetings. This is the pastry challenge, and this is coming up in a couple minutes. So everyone gets a bag. I leave work 2 days. There's little treats in there. Don't open the bag till we get, because we're going to have everyone guess what's in there, so you can't open it until we get to that part. This is called the pastry challenge, and I'm going to give you clues, and we're all going to try to guess what it is in English, and then there's a Sicilian name for this treat, so don't open it yet. While they're passing that out, I do a couple of things at the meetings. I have recognition awards. I have awards for people that do a lot of work to help preserve our heritage and work really hard at it. Today's recognition award for this meeting today, there's a person here at CASA who works behind the scenes, who brings all these programs together and makes it happen, and brings all us people together, and needs to be recognized, Anna Weiser. So now we're going to take a trip to the Vatican. This is the Italian trivia part. Two parts questions, okay? Part A, when they're trying to elect the new pope, how long do the cardinals have time-wise to elect the new pope? Whoever gets it gets a prize. Huh? You're right. Absolutely right. Very good. That was pretty good. All right, second question. How long was the longest recorded time they take to elect the pope? And I'm going to give you a hint, it was quite a few years ago. It was back in the 1200s.
More than 2 years.
You're right. Anyone?
It's 70s.
Got it, you're right.
1268 to 1271.
It was 2 years, 9 months, and 2 days.
Yeah, for even the ceiling.
Yeah, Gregory the 10th.
So then we didn't have a vote for 2 years?
2 years, 9 months, and 2 days. That's the record.
What was the reason?
Yeah, 1268 to 1271.
What was the reason why?
That I don't know. Politics, like everything else.
French King, one down, cold.
Okay. There you go. Did everyone get them in the bank? All right, pastry challenge, a trip to Sicily. So everyone knows, over the years, Sicily was invaded by different cultures, civilizations. And they left marks of, you know, politics, economics, culinary, right? So everything you eat and drink is, you know, all these different civilizations. The texture, the flavor, have a little spot here and there. So today's treat is a cookie, okay? I'll give you clues, we try to guess. I'm gonna give you simple clues. In the US, it's mostly around Christmas time that we make them. And in Sicily, it's usually around All Saints Day. One of the, yeah. I'll give you a clue that just about gives it away. Italian meatball cookies. No.
Sesame cookies.
No. There's the Italian word, or the Sicilian word name for the cookie that I'm looking for, apparently means for you, for me, one for you, one for me. I'm figuring with this hardcore Italian group, something's gonna happen. No, not yet. All right, the Sicilian word is four letters. Starts with a T. Tattoo. Tattoo. So yeah, chocolate spice cookies. There you go, now you can all hear.
Okay, so our next author is Louis Rosati, and Louis is a native of Lockport, New York. He's a retired doctor of pathology. He's the author of Men of Steel, Mind Winning Season, The Boy in Abruzzo, a novel of World War II Italy. And his family's from Abruzzo, and the people of Abruzzo are described as forte and gentile, which means strong and kind. And Louis is the epitome of this. He is a true gentleman. Louis Rosati.
Thank you, Frank. Thank you very much. Thanks to all the people at Casa Italia for this invitation. And it's a pleasure to be here. And all of you, I thank all of you for coming. And when I got the invitation set, that basically said, speak about your Italian-American upbringing and your book. So basically, my book is the last book I wrote with The Boy in Abruzzo, but all of my history of growing up Italian-American is in my first book, so I thought I would title this My Italian-American Life in Three Books. So can I have the next slide? So my winning season is like a two-part memoir. It was a sports memoir, is the thread through the book, but basically it's about growing up Italian-American in this Italian West End of Lockport, New York. So the season, the baseball season, was the summer of 1954. We won the city championship, and at the banquet at the end of the year, Sal Magley showed the hero of the 1954 World Series for the Giants. Meeting Cleveland was Sal Magley came to the banquet, and the newspaper caption said, "The champs meet the champ." What a way to end the winning season. So, next slide. So, each of us in this room have a unique story. Each of us, Italian Americans and others, we have a unique story. Mine is different from every one of us in this room. We heard a lot about this, but we share so much of our Italian-American heritage. So in that context, I wanted to tell my story in that context of what we share together. Next. So why are we here? Well, we're here because of the reorganization, the unification of Italy under the Piedmontese Constitution caused such political upheaval, and then the abuses of the Gilded Age in Europe, the Belle Epoque. Next. Taken together, the political upheaval and the socioeconomic disruption in the country caused Italy to bleed out and hemorrhage its citizens, so many from the southern Italian region. So the motivation, of course, was economic survival. And many of the men who went back and forth to European countries and North and South America and in the U.S. I had a grandfather, my grandfather Luigi, after whom I'm named, was a Golondrino. That's what the Argentines called the swallows, because they went back and came back. And I know how many trips he made, because every time my grandfather Luigi came back, about 9 months later, one of my aunts was born. So I know he made at least four trips, besides my father, my other grandfather. And so he left, go ahead. My other grandparents. So they left. This is Rocca Marice. It's on this jutting peninsula, but it's along this ravine here. And then both of my grandfathers came from this town. My maternal and my paternal grandfather all had slightly different histories. And this is my mother's hometown, which is just down below Leto Montepello, and we call, they're both affectionately known as La Rocca and Lulette. So next slide. So what were the magnets? The magnets were in all these other countries, they had labor contractors, right? And regional recruiters that went around in the Abruzzo and or whatever region it was, and they would hire guys to go to or send these people to these various countries. And then by chain migration, both of my grandfathers eventually ended up in the United States. Next. In Lockport, New York, and this is there's also a Lockport, Illinois, the only two Lockports in the United States. Anyway, this is the Erie Canal. Here in Lockport, gets its name by the series of locks on the Niagara Escarpment. So basically, divides the town. This is the East End, the West End, and this is the Italian neighborhood is out this way. So next. So our enclaves. We all have stories about our neighborhoods, right? The churches, St. Anthony's, where I grew up, was the heart of the social programs and so on in the neighborhood. The language, all the dialects, the Abruzzese dialect I heard, and the Neapolitan dialects and the Calabrese dialects, but mostly Abruzzese in our area. Our house, our home, with all the borders and all the work that went with all of that, and how that was a win-win situation for everybody. The Depression years and the lack of work and everything, and the World War II years, how everything changed, and my family, we moved up into the middle class because of World War II. Next. So this is the house where I grew up, and this is my grandparents. It's my grandparents' house where I spent the first 5 years of my life. My grandfather Antonio, Chiara, my grandmother, and my Aunt Anna, who died of tuberculosis, largely because at 16, visitors who were living there, and she, a woman with a serious disease, it was TB, and she eventually contracted it and died. And this is my mother, the only redhead in the West End of New York. But anyway, this is a wonderful neighborhood with all these Italian homes and little businesses here, tucked here and there, and bars and restaurants and grocery stores, and it was so lively. It's such a wonderful thing, and I never thought it was going to go away, but I never gave it a thought that one day this wouldn't exist anymore. And now it's kind of bittersweet when I go home to see it's not there, you know, and it's all deteriorated. Next slide. And of course, we all share in the culture, you know, the celebrations, the food, the Sunday, and all the holidays, you know, we put the Italian meal on top of the American meal, you know, the pasta first course and the turkey, so, you know, all those dishes, you know, and spend the whole afternoon. And my favorite eventually became Christmas Eve, but I didn't like it as a kid. I didn't like all the fish and all the pasta and the anchovies and the stuff, you know, but eventually I came to cherish that night. And I still keep that tradition. Next. That's me and my mother making pasta. You know, that's the kind of the newer way. Next slide. Compared, there's the pasta. The Abruzzese say pasta of
La guitarra,
right? There's the guitar.
Yeah.
The guitar and making it go away. And everybody's, of course, everybody talks about their mother's sugo, but you know, waking up on a Sunday morning to smell that aroma that gets up to the upstairs bedrooms and stuff, and you come down to hear that the meat sizzling and the stones. But just a couple of other favorite things, the spadini, we call them the spadooch. And it's amazing, you can buy, you know, we just came back from Canada visiting all my relatives in Hamilton and Toronto. You buy these in the grocery store already with the skewers on them, and all you have to do is open them. Lamb skewers. There are those cubes of lamb, you have each one, and just salt, pepper, and olive oil. That's all the Italian need to do, you know, and they're beautiful. Yeah, I can't get them in Phoenix or anything, but. And then porchetta. There's one more slide. The pizzellas. Our pizzellas were always filled with, we doubled them, you know, and you put a great chocolate, you know, and all kinds of other things, but that's basically it. And you do it seasonally. In the summer, it's cherry, in the winter, grape. Finally, assimilation from the Little Italy's upward mobility. I mentioned, you know, of the first and second generations, and I'm an example of that. So many of these people, many of you are also, and we've had probably one of the most successful assimilations in this country, and I think we're a model. We should be a model for some of the newer immigrants that have come and are struggling. Next. So that my next book I wrote, it was just a sort of a continuation memoir, is Men of Steel. And this is a tap and pour from an electric furnace in Lockport. We made, the steel mill made specialty steel. It's a low carbon, high alloy type steel, stainless, stainless and tool steel, magnetic steel, a lot of steel that was used like in surgical instruments and even in the jet, like jet engines and so on, aeronautical steel. So both of my, Anyway, both of my grandfathers worked there. Their brothers, my uncles, cousins, and it's all between college years, I decided I was going to add another generation to the steel mill. And so here it is, and it's probably an effigy in about 1960. And this is the Italian are the Italian West Side. You can see it's on the edge, it's almost a part of the neighborhood. Here it sits along, the Erie Canal here. And this is it today. So it was the same year it went bankrupt, was the same year Bethlehem did, in 1982. And there's also a toxic legacy because during the Cold War years, they made uranium steel, the nuke for rods, steel rods for nuclear reactors. The workers didn't know that. They were exposed to uranium in large amounts, and many people obviously died, including my father, of lung cancer. He was also a smoker, so they had to educate these, how much was due to smoking and everything. And in my father's case, there was a lot of paperwork, obviously, back and forth. 86.5%, they said, was due to the uranium. anyway, it was part of the settlement that they did with nuclear workers. That's still an issue today. As anybody who's seen Oppenheimer and so on, you know, the downwinders, there's a big issue in New Mexico, Arizona, and these other, and all the Cold War era stuff like this that went on. Next, so this is the sheet mill where my father worked and his crew. Next, that's the guy, this is the crew during one of their breaks, that's my dad. And then the following year after this picture was taken was the year I worked there. And is there one more? Yeah, and then I went to find the steel, the sheet mill, one of the rollers many years after, because when the plant closed up, they had an auction for some of the material, and another steel company in the area, another specialty steel company, bought this thing. So I traced it down and took a picture of that. Next. So that brings me to the book that I wanted to talk about today. This is a novel. The other two books were totally nonfiction. This is a novel, so it's nine. It's big. There was an incident, a true incident, but 96% of this book is my imagination. Next. So the setting is the Abruzzo region. Next. So when I'm speaking to most audiences back home, and most Americans don't know where that is, it's in the central part of Italy. But Italy is always divided, you know, they didn't consider themselves central. There's north and there's south, that's it. And where you, what's considered south depends on where you live. In Bologna, it's the Po River. If you live in Florence, it's below the Arno, and so on. So this is the Abruzzo. It has both the maritime area, beautiful seashore communities and stuff, and the mountainous region. Kind of broken into two regions, the Gran Sasso of the Apennines and the Maiella, where the story takes place. Yeah. Next. And then World War II history. Always an enduring subject, very popular. World War II books will always continue to sell. So my story, as you know, the landings took place in Sicily. The action was Patton's Third Army at that point, the British Eighth Army, eventually the Fifth was the Third was reorganized in the Fifth Army that made the landing in Salerno under Clark. Okay. The British Eighth Army then moved up the Apennine, the eastern side of the Adriatic. Next line is probably a little clearer. So here it is here. So the Americans are on this side of the Apennines, the British Eighth Army, and they're composed of the Commonwealth nations. So there's Britain and all the Commonwealth, Australians, Canadians, and so on. So that army, this part of the war is not as well known as this part. For us in the United States, but this is the setting for the book. So Hitler's man in Italy, Kesselring, was told, you have to hold this line along the Sangro River. This was also known as the Gustav Line or the Winter Line. So all of Italy above this is occupied, German-occupied country, and here the Allies are moving up, and this is the setting for my story. Next. So the town of Roccamerice, like many villages in Italy, was under German occupation at the time, and that meant severe restrictions, rationalization, rationing, severe rationing, tremendous hunger, confiscation of everything. It was a very demoralizing time. And my hero, Francesco, a 15-year-old boy, is fed up. He's hungry, starving, and he's also had a tough time with one of the German officers. So together, his hunger plus the German issue forces him to leave town. He walks, next slide. So he leaves Rocca Marice here in the Maiellas, and he walks to the town of nearby Caramanico, where a family takes him in. Next slide. But the family also is harboring two escaped prisoners of war from the prisoner of war camp near Sulmona. Camp number 78, they had like over 3,000, mostly British captives from Africa and Sicily. So two of these, they scatter when the Italian guards walk out after the country collapses, these men all scatter. Some of them hung around thinking the Allies were gonna save them. Unfortunately, the Germans came and recaptured them. But others scattered in all sorts of directions, including a couple that found their way to Caramanico, a Canadian officer and a British officer. So Francesco, the patron of the home, is disillusioned by the Italian government anyway, and is kind of part of an early resistance in the Maiella. And he has this plan to escape, to take these prisoners of war back to their armies that are advancing up the Adriatic. So my hero, Francesco, decides that he wants to put aside a budding romance with the daughter in the house and leads these two people along with a chef, a real shepherd, and men of the resistance along the way. So they leave. They leave Caramanico, and they journey through Santo Spirito. That's actually Celestine the Fifth Pope. It was one of his places here, Santo Spirito, and then down. And the idea is to leave the sheep. I'm getting ahead of myself. Next slide. So part of the Transumanza is a big part of Italy culture in the Abruzzo region, even to this day, where they, as winter approaches in the fall, they bring the sheep to lower elevations, and then usually they go to Puglia. But the war on, he decided he's gonna bring the sheep as far as Casoli, close to the Sangro River, to his brother's farm. So Francesco then leads these men down there. He sees them escape across the Sangro River. They finally escape across the Sangro River, and he returns. He returns, and then in Caramanico, a tragic episode, and a near-death experience leaves Francesco in shock and trauma, and he goes home to Rocca Marice. Next slide. So it's December now in Rocca Marice, and he's suffering from what we would call today PTSD. But in those days, that term didn't exist and so on. But he learns that the two prisoners of war that he helped escape, spearheaded by the Canadian 1st Division, and the Canadian and the other British troops are moving up for the battle at Ortona. And he says, these are the only two people that understand my trauma, and he wanted to share with them. So he makes his way to Ortona, and he meets up with the Canadian officer who, they start a healing kind of process through a psychiatrist that he, in the military, that he has him talk to. So Ortona, the Battle of Ortona is like Italy's Stalingrad. It was a tremendous battle. It was the first battle of World War II that went house to house, room by room. I mean, it was an incredible battle, and there would be more like that later in the war, you know, in France and Germany. But at this time, this was the first really close encounter. And we gotta give the Canadian 1st Division credit for that. They were tremendous fighters all through World War II. So on the last day of 1943, December 31st, New Year's Eve, there's a big celebration, and Francesco begins a healing process. Next. And then the story concludes 10 years later on the Niagara Peninsula. It's now, my hero, Francesco, is a steel worker at Simon's that I showed you the steel mill about. And the Canadian soldier is at McMaster University. He's a history professor, and he specializes in Nazi war crimes in Italy. So the two of them get together next in Hamilton, and their search for justice begins. That's where my story ends. Next. So that's my story of my Italian life, my Italian American life in three books. And I hope there'll be a fourth. Any questions I can answer for you?
Yeah. You're on the baseball team there?
Yeah.
That was 1952?
54.
54. Are you in the grade?
Yes, we had.
That's amazing.
It's unusual, huh?
Yeah.
Lockport, New York, 1954.
And where's your
two black players?
Where are you now?
Al Rose. Al, we call him Gator.
Gator.
Gator Rose from Lockport. That's Jimmy Watkins, that's me.
Yes. Excellent.
Yeah. In fact, I'll tell you that team. This was a West End team, and Bob Newton, a star pitcher, his mother, so he's Italian on his parents' side. Mario Angelucci, Rick Casanova, Lou Rosati, Vic Amoroso, Nicoli. Anyway, six of the nine guys were Italian. Six of the guys were Italian American. Yes.
I have a connection with the Blue Sea. You know what Pescara is?
Yes. Yeah.
I mean, a famous Italian writer was born in Pescara. You know that?
Salome.
Gabriele D'Annunzio.
D'Annunzio. Yeah.
So you know, I have a connection.
Yeah, D'Annunzio, yes.
Poetry about the Transumanza you mentioned, about Transumanza. You know that beautiful poet is called I Pastori.
I
Pastori.
So there's, you mentioned the D'Annunzio, and then there's also Salone, right?
Salone, yeah.
The great Italian
writer.
Yes, his trilogy, you know, the trilogy, Fontamara, Seek Beneath the Snow, and anyway, I finally discovered the English translations now. They put all three in a book, in one.
We have them here.
You do have it here, in English?
In Italian.
Oh, I got the Italian version too, but I can't read it.
In 4 or 5 minutes, we'll begin with the
Should we just do the play? Because if we take a break,
I've been overruled. That's okay. But if you have to go, you have to go. But stay there, please.
We'll give a break right after the play. So.
Jerry Quillico has been involved in journalism and with Toronto for many years, and he's also the co-author with Paul Basil of A Viva La Festa, A Spiritual Journey from Italy to Chicago. He's one of our volunteers, and for the last several years he has authored and produced a short play for our IAMI audiences. This year, the play is about Italian Americans in baseball. So, Give it, take it away, Sherry.
This is kind of a esoteric play, although this is the fourth play we've done here, and all these plays are esoteric. So, and we have, and actually we have a fifth one, which has been judged not fit for human consumption. But next year we're going to do it. That's called the Maltese Moscato. So anyway, this year it's about baseball. The first professional baseball team was formed in Cincinnati in 1869, 155 years ago. So we can mark this as the birth of what has been called the American pastime. The National League was founded in 1876 and the American League in 1901. And most of the participants were from the British Isles and Germany. So it would not be long before the game became a sort of American melting pot on steroids. Well, maybe steroids is not a good reference we want to make because of what happened in baseball from the 1980s to 2000, the use of steroids. The game became a way for Italian Americans to be recognized and eventually accepted by their Mayflower peers. And despite all the trials over the years, Sacco and Vanzetti, the rise of the Ku Klux Klan, anti-immigration laws, lynchings, being confined to ghettos, fascism in World War II, with Italy fighting against the U.S. for a while, many of the Italians' suspended players rose to hero status, and not just in the Italian community. Florence Baldassaro, in his great book, Beyond DiMaggio, Italian Americans in Baseball, tells us that the first professional player of Italian descent was Ed Abaticchio, who played between 1897 and 1910 for nine seasons with Philadelphia, Boston, and Pittsburgh, and for a time was the highest paid player in the bigs. Before him, there was Nicholas Apollonio, who was president of the Boston Baseball Club when the National League was formed in 1876. The first Italian player to be termed a superstar was Tony Lazzari, who, despite being an epileptic, was signed by the Yankees in 1925 and played second base for 12 years from 1926 through 1937, and would then become a player coach for our own Chicago Cubs in 1938. The American and National Leagues had no teams west of St. Louis or south of Washington for many years. So there were other leagues where players were developed. Players such as Ping Bodhi, Billy Martin, the DiMaggios, Tony Lazzari, and Frankie Tricetti came through the Pacific Coast League with homes around San Francisco Bay. As these players received coverage in the press and then radio, and when fans were exposed to them at the parks, prejudices and preconceptions came to be out of balance with what they saw and heard. My father, when he left the coal mining town of Seatonville, Illinois, for the big city of Chicago, didn't forget about his sandlot days. So he began following professional ball in print and on the radio in the 1920s. And he was inspired and encouraged by their successes, feeling that if these guys, with so many vowels in their names, could succeed, so could he. He could feel pride in being Italian outside of the community and feel that he had a place in American life. And because of all the Italian players on the Yankees, he became a lifelong fan despite his Illinois roots. It is ironic that the rigid conservative culture of baseball would become a haven for Americans who are out of the mainstream. Of course, in 1947, when Branch Rickey, the owner of the Brooklyn Dodgers, signed the former second lieutenant, Jackie Robinson, with the proviso that no matter how much he's provoked, Jackie did not react negatively by word or deed in any manner for 3 years. By signing Robinson, Rickey destroyed the ironically termed gentleman's agreement that baseball owners had made to not allow Negro players into the white leagues. Now everything changed and all other ethnic players simply became white. In a few years, the Negro leagues that were so popular collapsed as more players moved to the majors. Branch Rickey was an idealist, but also a realist, as he realized that in the end, his move would bring more fans to the games, with the Negro teams that featured such legends as Satchel Paige and Buck O'Neill. When they played the white teams, the Negro teams would invariably win. By the way, from 1953 through 1954, Marcinia Lyle Stone, aka Tony Stone, played professional ball in the Negro League, the first woman to play professional baseball. At one point, filling Henry Aaron's second base position after he left to play for the Atlanta Braves. Well, this is another taboo that baseball broke, but not one they have gone on to fulfill. Teams during the spring training in the South began to circumvent Jim Crow laws by building or buying their own hotels so all their players could live and eat together. We think of the civil rights movement of the 1960s, but baseball was beginning to answer difficult questions about a decade and a half earlier. Now, the game of baseball is all about home. You start at home, and when you leave it, your goal is to get back to home. I think this was said by Mario Cuomo, whose big league career dreams were ended when he received a concussion and was told medically he had to give up the game. But he could still look up, like millions of his fellow citizens, to Jolton Joe DiMaggio as one of the immortals of the game. A. Bartlett Giametti, the great commissioner of baseball, who unfortunately died 6 months into his term, said, "For what is baseball, and indeed much of the American experience, if not about looking for home? The desire to return home gives us, a nation of immigrants, always migrating in search of home." As the subject of the play this afternoon, our big nose, big ear, 165 bundle of dynamite, Billy Martin, was named Alfred Manuel Martin at birth. But because his Italian grandmother, Raffaella, called him Bello, this became Billy for the rest of his life. He boozed and brawled his way through 11 years as a player, and then became a real game changer as a manager. Let me leave you with two stories that didn't make the play. The first one was revealed on an episode of the Dean Martin Celebrity Roast that targeted Billy and was told by his lifelong pal, Mickey Mantle. Mickey Mantle, our home was in Oklahoma, and Whitey Ford and Billy, they all liked to hunt. So they went to visit Mantle in his home, and Mickey said, "You know what? I've got a pal who owns a ranch. It's about 100 miles away. We got to drive there, but I'm sure we'll be able to hunt on his property. So we're going to go there." So they drive there. He leaves the two pals in the car. He goes in and talks to the rancher. He loves them. He signs autographs for the kids and everything. And the rancher has a request for him. He says, "Look, I got a mule. I have to put that mule down, and I haven't got the heart to do it. Can you do it for me?" Okay, so he agrees to do it, and Mickey walks back, gets his rifle out of the car. He says, "What are you guys doing?" He said, "No, that SOB, he won't let us hunt on his ranch. We came all this way, drove all this way out here, I'm going to teach him a lesson." So he's out of the car, he shoots the mule right in the middle of the head. All of a sudden, he hears two shots behind him. He looks back, and there's Billy with his gun, and there's two prize steers lying dead on the ground. And Billy says, "Do you want me to shoot some more?" Last story here is, in September of 1950, Phil Rizzuto, the Yankee shortstop, received a letter threatening him that said if he showed up in uniform against the Red Sox — now remember, this is the biggest rivalry ever in baseball, the Red Sox and the New York Yankees — if he showed up in uniform, he'd be shot. He turned the letter over to the FBI and told his manager, Casey Stengel. When the team took the field, they found out what Casey did. In Rizzuto's words, "You know what he did? He gave me a different uniform and gave mine to Billy Martin." Can you imagine that? I guess Casey thought it'd be better if Billy got shot. Now, inspiration for this play came from several places. First of all, I have to say it came from my son. We both read the Billy Martin book, thought it was the most fascinating story we ever read. And we both went to see the Yogi Berra movie, which was out and only lasted — great film, documentary about his life — only lasted like a week in the shows. So that got me thinking, man, we got a play here. I'll write about you. Well, I decided to write about Billy instead, but Billy was just too nice a guy. Sources of the play include Bill Bennington's Billy Martin's Baseball Small Genius, John Posada's Yogi, A Life Behind the Mask, and Harvey Frommer's The Ultimate Yankee Book, and Baseball, filmed by Ken Burns. This play is dedicated to Lawrence Baldassaro for his extensive body of work on Italians in baseball, and Dr. Louis Rosati, who will make winning season. And by the way, Doctor, my college was in Lockport, right next to Lockport, Illinois. The Romeoville, Illinois. I'm in the other Lockport. Well, we got a connection there. So at any rate, here it comes, Billy Martin. Remember me at all, it's probably as Yogi. I hated that nickname, by the way.